الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماءه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون والحمد لله الذي من علينا بمحمد صلى الله عليه وآله وبآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين واللعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم ومبغضيهم وغاصبي حقوقهم من ليلنا هذا إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه تبارك وتعالى في الكتاب المجيد والفرقان الحميد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ثم جعلناك على شريعة من الأمر فاتبعها ولا تتبع أهواء الذين لا يعلمون صلوات The verse that I have just recited is from Surah Al-Jathiyah, which says, O Prophet, we have then sent you with a set of laws. As per our command, and see that you follow our laws and do not follow the base desires and the wishes of those who do not know. I am quite conscious of the fact that we have a program tonight of A'mal and that it might take quite long. But tonight I have got something to say to a crowd of mu'mineen and mu'minat which assembles perhaps on very few nights. And I believe since life is, as we know, totally unpredictable and nobody knows whether we will be here again, or I do not know at least whether I will be alive in the next Ramadan or not, I feel that taking the refuge under the name of our first Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib I have to say a few words of utmost importance to the welfare of the Ummah in general and this community in particular. The most serious impediment and hurdle that we normally have in our lives is created by our base desires and our by very low wishes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by telling the Prophet not to obey the low desires and base wishes of himself, is actually telling us, as far as the Prophet was concerned, there was no question of any base desire because he was ma'soom. But through him, the lesson is for us that we have got to follow the sharia and not the desires. All the problems created in our lives emanate and originate from the strife and the struggle between the two. If you observe deeply and ponder over it, you'll find that we are torn between the two at every stage in life. Sometimes it is the will of God, and sometimes it is my own desire. And between these two, I sometimes obey Him and sometimes acquiesce in my own desires. And when I acquiesce in my own desires and submit to my own wishes, I commit those sins which thereafter I try to justify in the name of what we call modernization and the demand of the new times. This problem is not only confronting us on individual basis, it is a problem which has shown its face and stares and gazes right into the face of the whole Ummah. Had it not been so, the mausoleums and shrines of Karbala and Najaf would not have been demolished. Had it not been so, the ulama in Iran in Shah days, and the ulama in Iraq, and the ulama in Turk, and the ulama in Saudi Arabia, and in Jazeera, and the ulama in Bahrain, and the ulama in India and Pakistan would not have been killed. Some of them were tortured to death. Some of them were hanged publicly. And some of them were shot dead. Just because there stood a wall before the base desires, and the ulama stood up to speak the truth, and the people in authority did not like it. That which my desire dictates may be very, very attractive. When we are told not to eat najis, to go with a family for an evening to McDonald's is very attractive. Although it is haram meat, but we like it because our children want an outing. And now, na'udhu billah, there is no halal outing left in London except haram. We are told not to do that. Don't feed your children and your wives that which is najis. The attraction of promiscuity and permissive society in England and in the West, which began from the 60s and is now still on, has created havoc in this community and in the Muslim Ummah, where the families have broken down simply because people are attracted to the women of loose character. Take an example of the month of Ramadan. How many Muslims who are waiting eagerly for Eid are smoking in the days of Ramadan openly and eat without any scruple whatsoever? They are waiting for Eid. In fact, the shopping has begun. What is the Eid for that Muslim who has not had the taste of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? To believe in Allah and to submit to Him and to obey to Him requires some discipline. And a man is governed by the type of discipline he has adopted or she has adopted. We want to be as free as animals, as donkeys and cows, so that there is no discipline. Imam Jaffer Sadiq salawatullahu wasalamu alayhi said that he who does not pray salat is a kafir. Purposely, he leaves out. So somebody stood up and said, Yabna Rasulillah, is he a kafir? Kufr means infidelity. Kufr means disbelief. There can be a Muslim. His name is Islamic. His parents have been Muslim. He may be doing all other good deeds. And you say that he's a kafir. He said, yes. A man who does not fast is a sinner. But a man who does not pray is a kafir. And the result and the explanation that he gave was very pertinent to what I'm trying to tell today. He said, if a man does not fast, he can have so many excuses. He may say that I cannot keep hungry, for example. He can say that the weather is inclement and unkind, and I cannot bear the heat, for example. Or in these days, he can say, it is too cold to keep a fast. I require a cup of tea every hour. Hajj, many, many excuses are contrived. I cannot go for Hajj. Hajj people die there. I fear death, for example. Or I have rheumatism. I cannot walk. And so many. Imam alayhi salam says, for namaz, there can be no excuse but laziness, indifference, and disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is he demanding of me? 10 minutes in a day I cannot give him? Not for him, for myself, that I may confirm my faith before him so that my life is saved from the pitfalls and from bowing down over before the evil forces. It saves me so that I bow down before none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and acknowledge the blessings and the grace that I receive from him every day. I am not prepared for that, because my desire tells me that why? And this is how, when the first communist state was formed, they found it necessary to see that the very belief in Allah is undermined. Children of the state, children from your family, my family, your family, they were all gathered in one commune. And some of them were kept alive, but hungry for 3 days, 2 days. And after hunger, sustained hunger, endured hunger of 3 days, an apple would be kept on the table. And the teacher would say, you are all hungry, aren't you? He said, yes, we are hungry. You want this apple? Yes. Now pray to God to give you. Naturally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not coming from the heaven to take that apple and put into your mouth. And the children are lost, and suddenly they say, now ask the state to give you. And just as they say, we ask the state to give, the state supplies apples as much as they want. This is how, right from childhood, children in those countries were brainwashed to believe that the provider is man and not Allah. And right from the Vatican Church, an Arab was raised whose name is Michael Affleck. And he was told to create a new awakening among the Arabs so that they may talk of nationality first, Islam next. And he is a Christian Muslim, a Christian Arab, who became the first foundation layer of what is called Al-Ba'ath or Ba'athist party. Al-Ba'ath is resurrection or revival. And this was the feeling which was revived among those Arabs today who are in Iraq and who are also in Syria and Damascus. And the man has an audacity to write the book in which he says, O Arabs, my friends, Muhammad was a good Arab, and therefore we can be as good an Arab as Muhammad was. Islam was being undermined. Exactly the picture of Yazid's time came over before us, when the ulama were ridiculed, religion was being ridiculed. The time is come, my friends, my sisters and brothers, that the country which supplied us Mafatihul Janan does not have Mafatih. Aghahui asks us from London to supply Mafatihul Janan to Iraq. If any Zawar come there, please give them copies of book like Mafatih, which used to come from there to us. Today we are the suppliers to them, because in the haram there is no Mafatih, because they don't want you to even remember Hussein ibn Ali or Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. And the Muslims liked it then, the youths liked it, because it actually released them from the discipline of Sharia. It made them very, very liberal. Dancing parties from Philippines dancing parties from Far East countries started coming volume after volume into Baghdad to perform. And the youths liked it because that was how life they wanted to enjoy. That which was haram, the path to the haram was concealed and screened forever, and the youths were diverted to the nightclubs. So much so that last year, on the 12th night of Muharram, when normally we have a kafila of Banu Asad, which comes from their own location with a kafila to attend to the matam of Imam Hussein and to repent, because in the days of Imam Hussein, Banu Asad were there who did not attend to the burial immediately. They come here to recompense what their grandfathers could not do. They do it now. They come every year. The kafila of Banu Asad comes into Karbala. On that day last year, this kafila was also stopped, and on the very night, the government issued a publication to say that on this night there is a musical party in that particular club. And the youths went, because this is what my base desire dictates, that I rather dance, sing, and die than follow the dictates of Sharia. And Allah says, ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاكَ عَلَىٰ شَرِيعَةٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْرِ فَاتَّبِعْهَا وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَ الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. In 1924, from 22 to 24, so many ulama were assassinated in Turkey. And under the name of resurgence, revivalism, by the West, the Khilafat movement was eradicated. And the ulama were publicly hanged. And the women who came out with hijab, their hijab were actually pulled down. And the ulama wearing turban, their turbans were removed. And things like this, that even Arabic script of Quran Majid was banished from Turkey. Mosques were not allowed to give adhan. Under the name of modernization. Today, we have all these problems all over the world. Because there is a tussle. There is no tussle between anybody else. The tussle is between the will of Allah and the will of myself. Now, in Iran, the same thing happened. For 50 years under the Pahlavi regime, it began with Reza Shah, the father of the last Shah, where the parda and hijab was removed from the heads of the women. Sheikh Nuri was hanged publicly, Mujtahid A'lam. Many ulama were tortured, including Ayatollah Al-Khomeini Ridwanullah Alayh, who was slapped in the face in the palace of the king himself. And the people laughed. That is what they liked. The youths laughed. And when Ayatollah Khomeini rose, he rose against all odds. Don't forget the 15 years exile. Don't forget his imprisonment. Don't forget his deportation. It did not come like that. It came after a toil. And when it came, the youths of Tehran said that now that Agha has come, the greatest loss that we have suffered is that there will be no nightclub. There'll be no kabara. There'll be no singing. And there'll be no culture and things like that. The youths stood up against those youths who were trained and brought up under that particular training which encourages and promotes desire. Today we are in the West, in Western countries. And the allurement and attraction is here, the strongest. And if I say this with all the responsibility at my command, that if we do not wake up now, we are going to have a generation after this, and perhaps after that. Because in the life of a community, 50 years is not a long time. If you count 1972 from whence, the Mu'mineen from Uganda were forced to leave the country and came here, it's now nearly 20 years. of 50 years or 100 years in the life of a community is just a fraction of history. And within by that time, most of us will not be alive. But we, if we don't work now, we will not be able to leave a generation of Muslims. Leave aside Shia. Imam Zainul Abidin, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. After the sad tragedy of Karbala, once called his two or three companions, and he said, what is happening about the propagation of the message of Ahl al-Bayt? What is happening? They were elders. They said, Yabna Rasulullah, after Karbala, people are terrified. They love Ahl al-Bayt, but they cannot speak up. They are terrified because the authority is posing a danger. Karbala has happened where the son of Fatima Zahra was martyred. And with him, so many great ulama were martyred. So they are terrified. They don't speak up. Imam alayhi salam said, who are you approaching? He said, the elders. He said, no. Alaykum bil ahdaf. Alaykum bil ahdaf. Alaykum bil ahdaf. You have got to approach the young people, the young people, the young. Talk to them. Explain them. And this has got to be the program of our people, that we see that our youths, I'm told that Mullah Sahib speak in English. I don't mind. Normally the elders say speak in Urdu. I don't mind. As long as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided the gift of being able to talk in these languages, I will. But if I'm told to speak in English, I do ask why. And the answer I given is that the young people would like to listen. Where are those young people who I am approaching, and they are around this building smoking in the gullies? They think I don't see them. I see them. They are not here. They are somewhere in the nook and corner of Stanmore. Some of them under the pretext of volunteering in the car park. And some of them outside in rugby. Where are they? If the parents do not care to tell the young boy who is coming up, 17, 16, 15, that there is something in English and there is a madman sitting on mimbar who is telling you something, go and listen to him. Where are they? So, this majlis of 21st Ramadan is to revive the message and love of Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Who, as I explained in the last majlis, did not receive the acknowledgement of his contemporaries fully, only because he refused to succumb to their desires and he always submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was the thing. If, and permit me to say this, without any aspersion against anyone, if people started believing now that since Ayatollah al-Khomeini has passed away, therefore the warmth in religion also must fade, because he's no more now. So hijab was there as long as he was there. And the beard I wear because he is there, he was there. And I used to say khams salawat 5 times a day because he was there. Now he is dead, so that means everything is dead. Then let us not forget that he preached the religion of Allah and not his own. And the religion of Allah remains. Men come and go. Men come and go. The message is sustained. It endures against all odds. And his soul is pleased even today when he sees that people follow, and is displeased when he sees the people are forgetting. So to the ladies and gents, to my younger sisters who are coming up, and to my brothers, young ones who are now, inshallah, and the threshold of adolescence and growing up very soon, there is a message. And this message is to the whole community, wherever we reside, and to whichever group we belong, that unless and until there is a revival and the involvement of young people in the groups where religious study is carried out, where Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi anil Munkar goes on, where the young people themselves rise up to guide the young men themselves, there is going to be no salvation. To form volunteer groups, unions, sports groups is easy. But to form a nucleus of young people who will study religion, Islam, as much as they can, and make them the soldiers of Imam Zaman, Ajjalallahu Faraja, requires an awakening. How long can we live oblivious to what is going on around us? How long? Is Stanmore the world? Or for that matter, is our Haideria the world? Is it the end of it all and there is nothing beyond this? We are the least concerned as to what may happen wherever, and therefore, inshallah, everything is khair and good because everything seems rosy and good here. It's not so. We are equally responsible today, today, today. There are new, and I say this as a message, because I do not know of my life expectancy. And I feel, and I have been feeling the whole day today, that should I or should I not, and I finally decided that I should say this, that today there is a new group of Shia Ismailis in Malaysia, in Singapore, in Indonesia, in South Africa, in British Guiana, in Nigeria, the new Shias, who write to us that we have become Shia. How? Who went? Allahu Akbar. A letter is there in my file, anybody can come and refer. He writes, we were introduced to the teachings of Ali ibn Abi Talib and Ahlul Bayt, not by any missionary. It was only by that revolution which took place in Iran. And the moment we saw Ayatollah Khomeini's picture, we realized that here is a person dressed like the Prophet himself. The Prophet himself has come again. Sometimes it is the khulus and sincerity of purpose of a person which works. I was in Minnesota, in Minneapolis, at the opening ceremony of the Imam Bar there 3 years ago. And with me was marhum, our elder, Qasim Ali Bhai Hirji Walji, may Allah bless his soul in maghfirah. We were together, and many other mu'mineen. And just as we went to open the Imam Bar, we saw two white people standing there. We thought they were Iranians. When we sat to eat after the ceremony, they came to me and sat next to me. And they said, we are red Indian Shia Ismailis. Red Indians. Of a particular tribe which they named. And when I said, if that is the case, I would like to come to your home and visit you at home. He said, don't come to my home because my wife, my daughter, my son, they are still idol worshippers. And when you will come home, you will see everything against Islam and I won't be able to give you even one cup of tea which is packed. But I am a Shia Ismaili, and so is my son-in-law. And we would like to learn more and more so that we may spread the faith among our people. So what is going to happen? Are we in this particular place with the money we have, with the intellect that we have, with the pen that we can use, with all the resources at our command, are we or are we not responsible for all these if we come to know about them? We are. That is a matter of distance. What about here? Allahu Akbar. I wish someday you could sit with me and I'd show you the cases that we are facing at the moment. When the youths behave the way, it does not become the behavior of a Muslim. When the families break up only because of the world and there is no consideration for akhirah. when people do businesses which are haram out and out. There is a need. There is some conscious and also some burning within which is required. We just cannot keep our eyes shut and say everything is rosy. MashaAllah. Ever since Stanmore, Imam Bara has been there, and ever since Haidari there, ever since Dara Jafariya is there, everywhere there is revival, MashaAllah, Iman is spreading. It is not so. Let us not be complacent. If you are catering for 15-20%, it is a marginal performance. What is happening to the balance of the people? Some of the youths, we never see them except on Ashura Day. Where are they? And it is my conviction that every family of ours needs Islam. Every family of ours needs Sharia. Every family, however they may seem to be carefree, heedless, but there comes a time in life when something within him tells him that there is no rescue but at the door of Ahlul Bayt. Why should we bring them only when they need? We should bring them when they realize and make them realize. It's not only when we need Ahlul Bayt that we come for another mantra and things like that or sukkah. We should be able to have that affiliation with them and adopt their system of life and their way of life, which is the only Sharia. And it has got to be by awakening, not by complacence. Other programs will go on. The program of any Jamaat, the program of any federation, the program of any organization has got to be above the routine. The routine goes on. The majlises are held, the Imam Bara is renovated, the shoe rack is being made, the fence will be mended, the lawn, grass lawn will be made. These things are all rudimentary. What is happening to the people who have got to come here? Otherwise, when I was in Karbala for Ziyarat, and I went to see Sayyid Muhammad Kazim Qazwini, in those days, he told me, read this letter. I read the letter, it was from Algeria. An Arab Sayyid family. Sayyid means Sayyid, the descendant of Imam Hassan, Hassani, is writing to Sayyid Qazwini that we on 10th of Muharram close down our businesses, shut our doors and sit at home from morning till dawn. We don't do anything but we wear black clothes, and our elders sometimes shed tears but we don't, because we don't know what to do. And afternoon we slaughter an animal and then we feed ourselves and also the neighbors. We don't know why we are doing it. And the answer he gave, which I read, was, but this is Ashura. On this day, Husayn ibn Ali was martyred. On this day, that sad event took place. And your forefathers and grandfathers must have been Shia. So they were observing this, they have left a tradition. The soul has been lost. This will be happening to us, that we will have this Imam Bara for 100, 200, 300 years, inshallah ta'ala. All the Husayniyas will remain. Nothing can be demolished. But what will happen is that, the way Allama Iqbal said, Reh gayi rasm azam, ruhe bilali na rahi. Reh gayi rasme azan ruhe bilali na rahi, falsafa reh gaya talqin ghazali na rahi. This is what will happen, that the soul will be lost and the people will assemble, come and go without knowing what they are doing. Are we preparing our generation for this destiny, or are we preparing them to become Muslims even better than we are? So, to sum it up all, there is a need of the awakening and the cry from the young people, men and women, to stand up and say, we want to organize ourselves into a group whereby we will save ourselves by learning and by dissemination. We don't want to stop sports. It is a good thing. Healthy minds reside in healthy bodies. We don't want to stop any other activities. We don't want to stop unions. We don't want to stop literary sections. We don't want to stop debates. We want to continue with all those intellectual pursuits. But what is most essential is iman and faith, which has got to be promoted properly so that no power on earth. Before I complete, then what happened? Michael Aflaq, who changed the face of Middle East by actually distracting them from the path of religion, offering that which they desired and loved for the sake of enjoyment and rejoicing, was given a gold medal by the Pope for the work that he did. He was given a gold medal. Before he died, he was given a gold medal for the services in the Middle East. What were the services? The services of undermining Islam and actually demolishing that warmth which we have for Ahlul Bayt and for Islam. There's something else. When he died, that Saddam Hussein gave a statement that before dying, Michael Aflaq became a Muslim. In answer to this, I'll say only one thing. When Fir'aun was drowning, Quran says, when Fir'aun was drowning in Nile, at that particular moment he said, "Amantu bi Rabbi Musa wa Harun." I now believe and have faith in the God of Musa and Harun. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as tafsirs indicate, sent Jibril Amin and took the mud from the bed of the river and put him into his mouth and said, "Al-an, now, now, it's too late. It's too late." Even if I were to give credence to what he says, it was too late, because the damage was done and is done. So when you look at the political developments around you, don't look at it as an isolated event. It has been methodically, systematically planned. And pray to Allah, especially tonight and on the night of the Qadr, that we are saved from that. Mere dosto, gham ki raat ko gham se zyada kya bayan kiya jaye? Magar ek do baatein isi silsile mein sunte jaye. Jab Muawiya ne Amr ibn al-As ko khat likha ke a jao ke main tumhe apna wazir azam banau, wo Egypt mein tha. Muawiya ne khat likha ke a jao main tumhe prime minister banau. Sahib al-Ghadir kitab hai, Sheikh Abdul Hussein al-Amini rahmatullah alayh likhte hain ke usne apne do beton ko bulaya, ek ka naam tha Ali, ek ka naam tha Abdullah. بٹھلایا دونوں بچے جوان تھے. کہا سنو یہ خط آیا ہے معاویہ کا اور مجھے بنا رہے ہیں پرائم منسٹر. آپ لوگوں کی کیا رائے ہے, کیا اپینین؟ تو ایک لڑکے نے کہا, بابا اگر دنیا چاہتے ہیں تو چلے جائیے, اگر خدا کی مرضی چاہتے ہیں تو نہ جائیے, اس لیے کہ یہ علی کا دشمن ہے اور جس نے علی کی دشمنی کی اس نے اپنا ایمان کھویا. اگر آپ دنیا چاہتے ہیں اور اپنی ہوا و ہوس, اپنی بیس ڈیزائرز, اپنی خواہش کو نبھانا چاہتے ہیں تو جائیے. اب دو بچوں میں اپینین کا فرق ہو گیا. ایک کہتا ہے جائیے, ایک کہتا ہے نہ جائیے. تو صاحب الغدیر لکھتے ہیں کہ کبھی اس کی بات سن کر گھوڑا منگوایا کہ جاتا ہوں, کبھی اس کی بات سن کے گھوڑا واپس بھیجا کہ نہیں جاتا ہوں, پھر اس کی بات سنی پھر منگوایا, اور پھر اس کی بات سنی پھر واپس کیا. یوں 7 مرتبہ اپنی سواری بلائی بھی اور واپس کی, اور آخر میں سواری پر بیٹھ کر گیا یہ کہتے ہوئے کہ دنیا جو ہے وہ نقد اور کیش ہے, کل کس نے دیکھا ہے, ادھار ہے. خواہش वो आया और जो कुछ किया उसने वो आप जानते हैं किया, जंग सिफीन लड़ी। सिफीन की लड़ाई में मुआविया और मौला अली के मुकाबले में आपस में ये जंग हुई। मैं ज्यादा पढ़ना नहीं चाहता। आखिरी दिन जबकि जंग खत्म हो रही थी, माल के अश्तर बढ़ते बढ़ते मुआविया के कैंप तक पहुंच चुका था। अब थोड़ी देर थी कि इधर हमला करते मालिक के अश्तर तख्ता उलट देते, खत्म हो जाता मुआविया। कि मुआविया ने इसी अम्र मिलास को बुला के कहा, इधर अब ये जा रहा है, अब हम खत्म हो रहे हैं, कोई रास्ता है? लड़ने की तो बात ना कर, इसलिए कि खुद तारीख में ये है कि खुद मौला अली ने एक मरतबा खड़े होकर कहा भी था, ए मुआविया, इतने मुसलमानों का खून बहाने की क्या जरूरत है, तू आ जा मेरे सामने और हम तुम लड़ लेते हैं। तो मुआविया न खुद लड़ा है न उसका बाप कभी लड़ा है। तो अम्र इब्न अल आस ने एक मरतबा जरा एक्साइट करने के लिए कहा कि जाना चाहिए, जाना चाहिए, तू जानता है कौन है, इसके सामने कौन खड़ा रह सकता, ये अली है भाई, ये असदुल्लाह है, तो तू जा, चलो तू जा, तो कहता है कि जा। तो गया वो अम्र इब्न अल आस, हाँ गया, और जब सामने आया है मौला ने, जब तलवार उठाई और हमला किया तो अब वो देखता है मौत आ रही है, तो उसने ऐसा काम किया जो कोई मर्द नहीं कर सकता। उसने अपना कपड़ा ही ऊंचा कर दिया और कपड़ा ऊंचा करके अपनी शर्मगाह को अली इब्न अबी तालिब की तरफ रखा और मौला ने लाहौल पढ़ के चेहरे को हटाया। यानी ये वो मकाम है जहां पर इस्मत का तकाजा है कि कोई हराम काम ना हो। और मौला ने एक मरतबा अपना चेहरा हटा लिया और कहा, ला हौला वला कुव्वता इल्ला बिल्लाह, ना मर्द का बेटा ना मर्द। वो भाग गया, खत्म हो गया बात। मौला ने जब वो चेहरा हटाया उसको इतनी फुर्सत मिली, फुर्सत मिली तो भागा। जब वापस आया जिंदगी भर मुआविया और मुआविया के लोग हमेशा कहते रहे और टोंट करते कि आए इब्ने आस, तू तो वो है कि जिसने अली के सामने जाकर कपड़ा अपना हटा दिया, तू मुसलमान, तू मर्द है। तो किसी की सकत थी नहीं, हिम्मत तो थी नहीं, और मालिक की अश्तर बढ़ रहा है, मौला अली देख रहे हैं कि अब खत्म हो रहा है। कि एक मरतबा इब्ने आस ने कहा कि मुआविया रास्ता एक ही है, अब वो भी फाइनल है, वो ये है कि नेजे मंगवाओ, नेजे स्पीयर्स, और उसके ऊपर कुरान रखो। कुरान रखे गए कुरान मजीद के, कोई कहता है तारीख में कि सिर्फ कवर्स थे, कोई कहते हैं कि पूरे कुरान थे, रखे और एक ग्रुप को आगे खड़ा कर दिया और कहा, ए अली के लश्करियों, अब लड़ना नहीं है, अब लड़ना नहीं है, कुरान हमारे और आपके दरमियान में जो जज है वो फैसला करे, उसके मुताबिक हम अमल करें, लड़ना छोड़ दो। चुनांचे वो एक ग्रुप खड़ा हो गया, हंगामी लड़ाई है और एक ग्रुप खड़ा है, कुरान हमारे दरमियान में फैसला करेगा, कुरान हमारे दरमियान में फैसला करेगा। यहां मौला अली के ऊपर लोगों ने कहा कि ये इन्होंने कुरान का नाम लिया है, अब कुरान फैसला करे, तो अब छोड़ दो, आप हुक्म दो मालिक अश्तर को कि वापस आ जाएं। मौला ने कहा, अजीब बात कही मौला ने, कहा क्या बात करते हो तुम, एक ये कुरान जो खामोश है और एक ये कुरान जो बोलता हुआ है। ये कुरान, इसने तो कभी कहा नहीं कि तुम अभी लड़ाई बंद करो, ये तो खामोश है, उसके ऊपर तफसीर है, उसके ऊपर इंटरप्रिटेशन है, मुझसे पूछो, मैं बोलता हुआ कुरान हूं। लोगों ने मौला से कहा कि अगर आपने अभी अभी मालिक के अश्तर को बुलाया नहीं तो हम आपको मार डालेंगे। और मालिक के अश्तर को उस वक्त बुलाया है कि मालिक के अश्तर ने खुद कहा है कि मैं हमेशा रोता रहा, हमेशा रोता रहा, अगर मेरे इमाम का हुक्म ना होता तो मैं कभी वापस ना आता, इसलिए कि कुछ घंटों की बात थी और मैं खत्म कर देता मुआविया को और उसी लश्कर को, मगर अली का हुक्म। दिल की ख्वाहिश ये थी कि मुआविया खत्म हो जाए, अल्लाह की ख्वाहिश ये थी कि अली की इताअत करो। कैसी ट्रेनिंग होती थी अली इब्न अबी तालिब की, आप एक एक आदमी को देखिए, सलमान फारसी रहमतुल्लाह अलैह, अबू दर गफारी रजी अल्लाह अन्हु, मिक़दाद इब्न अस्वद अल किंदी रिज़वानुल्लाह अलैह, बिलाल जितने दिन रहे, अम्मार इब्न यासिर, एक एक आप नाम लीजिए, जो भी अली के साथ रहा
وہ اسلامی ہسٹری کے اندر ایک عجیب اسوہ حسنہ اور عجیب آئیڈیل اور مثالی شخصیت لے کر آ, کمال ہے. یعنی کوئی ایک بتائے علی کی ٹریننگ نے علی کی خود کی لائف کو ریفلیکٹ کیا یا نہیں. جیسا ٹیچر ہوتا ہے ویسے اسٹوڈنٹ ہوتا ہے. مالک اشتر یہ وہ ہے, میں بتانا چاہتا ہوں کہ کیا ٹریننگ ہے کہ نفس کو توڑو, کہ جب ختم ہو گیا سارا قصہ اور مولا بھی شہید ہو گئے. مالک اشتر ایک مرتبہ جا رہے تھے راستے میں, کسی نے پہچانا نہیں. اب زمانہ وہ تھا کہ اب کوئی مالک اشتر کو جانتا نہیں. مالک اشتر کا بڑھاپے کا زمانہ, جو جاننے والے ہیں وہ جانتے ہیں کہ یہ مالک ہے, جو نہیں جانتے وہ نہیں جانتے. ایک بازار سے گزر رہے تھے, بازار آپ لوگوں نے عرب ممالک میں دیکھے ہیں, وہ بازار کی جو اوپر چھت ہوتی ہے, چھوٹی سی بازار, چھوٹا سا بالکل, یہیں دکان یہاں دکان. مالک گزر رہے تھے کہ ایک دکاندار نے, جیسے کہ ان لوگ کی عادت ہے آج بھی ہے, وہ پانی جب گندا پانی ہوتا ہے وہ پھینکتے باہر. ان سے پوچھے کیوں پھینکتے ہیں, کہتے ہیں ہم تو سروس کرتے ہیں, پبلک سروس کرتے ہیں, اس لیے کہ اتنی وہاں خاک اڑتی ہے کہ اگر پانی ڈالتے ہیں تو خاک بیٹھ جاتی ہے. مگر اس نے پانی پھینکا, اور پھینکا تو مالک وہاں سے گزر رہے تھے, اور مالک کے کپڑے پر جا کے پانی گندا گرا. تو مالک نے اس کی طرف دیکھا, تو وہ کہتے ہیں نا کبھی کہ وہ ساہوکار زیادہ چوری جو زبردست ہوتا ہے, وہ کہنے لگا کہ آپ جاتے ہیں راستہ دیکھتے نہیں, بس جاتے ہیں, ادھر ادھر دیکھا کب. مالک نے دیکھا کچھ نہیں کہا, اور وہ جا رہے تھے مسجد کی طرف. بازو کے دکاندار نے اس دکاندار سے کہا کہ تجھے معلوم ہے کہ یہ پانی تو نے کس پر پھینکا, اور پھینکنے کے بعد پھر ڈانٹتا ہے تو اس کو کہ دیکھتا ہے تجھے معلوم ہے وہ کون ہے. کہنے یا کہنے لگے مالک کے اشتر ہے. کہ مالک اشتر ہے, اب گھبرائے ہو کہ مالک کا غصہ اور مالک کی بہادری. تو اب وہ دوڑتا ہوا مالک اشتر کے پیچھے گیا. مالک اشتر مسجد میں تھے, نماز پڑھ رہے تھے, تو وہ انتظار کر رہا. جب مالک اشتر نماز پڑھ چکے تو اس طرح کے کہا کہ حضور میں نے پہچانا نہیں, آپ مجھے معاف کیجئے, آپ مجھے معاف کیجئے. آپ نے کہا کہ تجھے معافی مانگنے کی ضرورت ہی نہیں ہے, اس لیے کہ تو نے یہ کیا اور میں نے دوڑا کر نماز تیرے لیے پڑھی ہے کہ خدا تجھے معاف کرے اور مجھے بھی معاف کرے. کیوں کہ اگر میں غصہ کرتا تو میں اپنے نفس اور خواہش کے لیے کرتا کہ میں کیا بڑا آدمی ہوں کہ جس پر پانی پھینکا. میں نے خدا کا شکر ادا کیا کہ علی کی ٹریننگ میں مجھ میں وہ خواہش باقی نہیں رہی. بس دوستو, یہی وہ بات تھی. کیا علامہ شیخ عباس قمی علیہ الرحمہ لکھتے ہیں کہ جب تنگ آ گئے کہ کسی طرح سے علی کو میچ نہیں کر سکتے, اور ان کی زندگی کی طرف ہمیشہ نظر حسد کی, بغض کی اور کینے کی رکھتے تھے, تو پھر ان لوگوں نے میٹنگ میں یہ طے کیا کہ ہم کو نہ معاویہ چاہیے, نہ عمر بن العاص چاہیے, نہ علی بن ابی طالب چاہیے. یہ تاریخ ہے, اس کو لکھا ہے علماء نے. چنانچہ طے پایا کہ ایک ہی رات میں تین آدمی نکلیں گے, ایک شام جائے گا اور ایک آئے گا کوفہ, ایک مولا علی پر حملہ کرے گا اور دو جو ہیں ایک معاویہ کو اور ایک عمرو بن العاص کو مارے. اس دن صبح کی نماز پڑھانے کے لیے عمرو بن العاص گیا ہی نہیں. بھائی وہ جو خدا ہند عالم کی مرضی ہے, اس دن وہ گیا نہیں, اس نے کہا میں بیمار ہوں کسی اور کو بھیج دیا. وہ جو دوسرا گیا نا وہی ختم ہو گیا. اور معاویہ گیا مگر تلوار اس کو سر پہ نہیں لگی, ران پہ لگی, تھائی پر, اور اس کا زخم زندگی بھر بھرا نہیں, بلکہ اس میں سے ہمیشہ اتنی بدبو آتی تھی کہ زندگی بھر جب وہ آتا تھا دربار میں یا لوگوں سے ملتا تھا تو پہلے خوشبو بھرتا تھا جب جا کے بیٹھتا تھا عطر اور عطریات سے, اس لیے کہ اس سے بدبو آتی تھی, مگر بچ گیا. اور وہی رات وہ رات ہے جس رات کو مولا کائنات کے سر مبارک پر ضربت لگی, 19 جولائی. دوستو
مستحب ہے اور سنت ہے کہ جب کوئی بیمار ہو تو اس کو دیکھنے کے لیے جاتے ہیں, اس دیکھنے کو عیادت کہتے ہیں. بیمار کو جا کے دیکھنا عیادت ہے اور عیادت سنت ہے میرے دوستو. 19ویں شب کو مولا زخمی ہوئے تو 20ویں شب کو مولا بیمار ہیں گھر پر, اور آج 21ویں شب کو اس وقت تک جبکہ یہ وقت بج رہا ہے ابھی تک مولا کی زندگی کے کچھ گھنٹے باقی ہیں, بیمار ہیں. اور آئیے, زمانے نے ہم کو بڑی تاخیر سے پیدا کیا, اگر ہم اس وقت ہوتے تو بھی جاتے. آج ہم یہ کہیں مولا, لندن کے اس کونے میں جتنے مسلمان شیعہ آپ کے چاہنے والے بیٹھے ہیں آپ کو سلام کہتے ہیں. ہم جانتے ہیں کہ آپ بیمار ہیں, زخمی ہیں, ہم سلام کرتے ہیں اور دعا کرتے ہیں کہ پروردگارا ہمیں ہمیشہ آپ کی ولایت پر باقی رکھے. لوگ آتے تھے اور جاتے تھے, دیکھتے تھے, یہاں تک کہ جب 21ویں رات آئی میرے دوستو تو مولا نے امام حسن سے کہا کہ ان سے کہو کہ جو سوالات وہ پوچھنا چاہتے ہوں اس میں تخفیف کریں, یعنی اپنے سوالات کو سمپلیفائی کریں, اپنے سوالات کو کم کریں. خففوا عنی, تم ذرا تخفیف کرو, اس لیے کہ اب مجھ میں وہ طاقت نہیں ہے کہ میں جواب دے سکوں تفصیل سے. ہاں پوچھنا ہو پوچھ لو, مگر اب وہ طاقت نہیں ہے, تخفیف کرو. ایسے میں اسبغ بن نباتہ کہتے ہیں کہ میں دروازے پر باہر کھڑا کھڑا رو رہا تھا, اور میرے رونے کی جب آواز بلند ہوئی تو مولا نے امام حسن سے کہا کہ کوئی رو رہا ہے. تو امام نے باہر دیکھ کے کہا, اسبغ, کہنے لگے مجھے مولا کے پاس آنا ہے, مگر مولا کی حالت دیکھتا ہوں تو دل نہیں بڑھتا. تو مولا نے کہا اسے بلاؤ. جب اسبغ واپ اندر آئے ہیں تو اسبغ نے جب مولا کا حال دیکھا ہے, وہ خود روایت ہے, وہ ایک عجیب روایت ہے میرے دوستو. وہ کہتا ہے کہ میں نے دیکھا کہ ایک کپڑا مولا کی پیشانی پر بندھا ہے جس کے رنگ میں اور چہرے کے رنگ میں کوئی فرق باقی نہیں رہا. خون اتنا بہ چکا تھا کہ کپڑا جتنا زرد تھا اتنا ہی چہرہ امام کا زرد تھا. اور مولا نے کہا, اسبغ بولو کیا چاہتے ہو؟ کہا, مولا ایک حدیث آپ کی زبان سے سن لوں. مولا نے کہا, اسبغ تیرا ہاتھ بڑھا. اسبغ نے ہاتھ بڑھایا, مولا نے دو انگلیاں رکھی اور کہا, قال رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وآلہ وسلم, یا علی انا وانت ابوا هذه الامه. رسول اللہ نے فرمایا تھا, اے علی, میں اور تو دونوں اس امت کے باپ ہیں. یہ کہہ کر مولا نے انگلیاں اپنی واپس کھینچ لیں اور اسبغ کا ہاتھ یوں ہی رہ گیا. اور اس نے کہا, مولا تو کیا اس کا مطلب یہ ہوا کہ یتیمی کا وقت آیا ہے؟ اس کے بعد کہا, مولا کچھ نصیحت کرو, کچھ نصیحت کیجئے. آپ نے فرمایا, اے اسبغ, اس سے بڑھ کر کوئی نصیحت ہو نہیں سکتی کہ کل تک علی تیرے ساتھ تھا, آج تیرا مہمان ہے اور کل دنیا میں نہ ہوگا. موت سے بڑھ کر کوئی دنیا میں واعظ نہیں ہے اسبغ. اب جا کہ مجھے کچھ وصیتیں کرنی ہے, مجھے کچھ اہل بیت سے ملاقات بھی باقی ہے. اب خدا حافظ. اسبغ گئے اور مولا نے حکم دیا امام حسن کو, گھر کے تمام بچوں کو, بیویوں کو, سب کو بلایا گیا. بس دوستو, ایک ایک کو وصیت کرتے رہے. روایت کہتی ہے کہ سب سے دور ایک خاتون کھڑی تھی جس کے ہاتھ میں ایک چھوٹا سا بچہ تھا, باقی تمام بیویاں کھڑی تھیں. زینب علیہ السلام سینے پر تھی اور دیکھتی ہیں کہ مولا رو رہے ہیں. ایک مرتبہ زینب نے کہا, بابا آپ رو رہے ہیں, کیا میں جو نزدیک سینے پر آئی ہوں کوئی تکلیف ہو رہی ہے؟ فرمایا, بیٹی نہیں, بیٹی نہیں, ام ایمن کی روایت یاد ہے؟ بیٹی ام ایمن کی روایت یاد ہے؟ ارے آج
जिसको शहजादी कूफा जी कहते हैं। ज़ैनब उस दिन को भी याद करना जबकि कूफी तुम्हें यहां पर बेपर्दा लाएंगे और शानों में रसन बंधे होंगे, उस वक्त तू कैदी बन के आएगी। ज़ैनब उम्मत के हक में बद्दुआ ना करना,
सब्र करना। इसके बाद इमाम हसन को बुलाया, इमाम हुसैन का हाथ इमाम हसन के हाथ में दिया और कहा हुसैन ये मेरे बाद मेरे वसी हैं। और इसके बाद हर एक का हाथ मिलाते रहे, तमाम अपनी औलाद का हाथ इमाम हसन से मिलाते रहे और कहा ये मेरे वसी हैं, इसके बाद इन्हीं के हुक्म पे अमल करोगे। एक खातून कोने में खड़ी है, एक बच्चा हाथ में है और रो रही है। एक मरतबा देखा मौला ने कहा उम्मुल बनीन क्यों रोती हो? कहा मौला हर एक का हाथ हसन के हाथ में दिया गया, मेरा अब्बास बाकी है, क्या इनको हवाले न करेंगे? कहा करीब आओ करीब आओ। अब्बास का हाथ लिया और हुसैन के हाथ में दिया और कहा अब्बास हम न होंगे, हमारी नियाबत में हुसैन की नियाबत। दोस्तों ये वो वसीयत है जो मारकतुल आरा है, इमाम हसन रिवायत करते हैं। नमाज सुबह के वक्त से कुछ वक्त पहले मौला ने एक मर्तबा अपने आप को किबले की तरफ लिटाया, बस दोस्तों किबले की तरफ लिटाया और कहा बिस्मिल्लाह व बिल्लाह व अला मिल्लति रसूलिल्लाह। और इसके बाद एक जुमला कहा है जो सूरह वस्साफात की आयत है, पढ़ते हैं बिस्मिल्लाहिर रहमानिर रहीम फलिमिथलि हाज़ा फलयअमलिल आमिलून। ऐ दुनिया में अमल करने वालों ऐसा अमल करो जैसा कि अली ने किया है। और एक मर्तबा दुनिया से उठ गए मेरे आका जन्नत को सिदारे और एक मर्तबा कोहराम बरपा हो गया। बस मैंने खत्म किया। वसीयत में कहा था इमाम हसन से कि बेटा गुस्ल दे जाओ कफन दे दो, उसके बाद मेरे जनाजे के दो हिस्सों को तुम दोनों भाई संभाल लेना और अगले हिस्सों को संभालने की जरूरत नहीं है, फिक्र न करना फिक्र न करना। पीछे दो हिस्से संभाल लेना, आगे आगे न जाना, वहां मलाइका उठाएंगे। ये मौला ने फरमाया कि मलाइका आएंगे उठाएंगे और जहां ले जाएं वहीं दफन कर देना। बस दोस्तों गरी पर कूफे की पुश्त पर जिसको आज नजफ कहते हैं वहां पर जाके खुद ब खुद जनाजा रुका और इमाम हसन ने एक थोड़ी सी मिट्टी हटाई, एक खुदी हुई कब्र तैयार निकली जिसमें लिखा था ये कब्र वो है जिसको आदम ने वसीय रसूल के लिए तैयार रखी है। उतरे इमाम हसन, मौला को लिटाया। बस दो बातें, ये दो भाई हैं यतीम इमाम अली हैं, लिटा चुके लहद में, कब्र थोड़ी सी बंद कर चुके। इसके बाद इमाम हसन ने इमाम हुसैन को देखा, इमाम हुसैन ने इमाम हसन को देखा और कब्र के अंदर दोनों भाई बगलगीर हुए और इतना रोए कि आवाज आई ऐ अली के यतीमों सब्र करो सब्र करो, कि सब्र की मंजिल है निकले बाहर कब्र बंद। इमाम हसन फरमाते हैं कि रोजाना मैं जाता था वहां पर, सलाम करता था दुआ करता था। एक तीसरे दिन जब मैं अकेला वापस आ ही रहा था कि एक गली से आवाज आई अरे मुझ पर एहसान करने वाले खुदा तुझको सलामत रखे, तीन दिन हो गए तू आता नहीं। क्या तू बीमार है? क्या तू दुनिया से उठ गया है? क्या तू मुझे भूल गया है? तुझे नहीं मालूम कि मैं भूखा हूं? इमाम हसन बैठ गए, अंधा था एक अपाहिज भी था। मौला ने कहा क्या बात है भाई किसको याद करता है? तो उसने कहा एक आता था आके मेरे पास यहां बैठता था और मुझे कहता था ले मैं तुझे अपने हाथ से खिलाऊं, ले तू खा। और जब मैं कहता था कि मैं शेर हो चुका तो कहते थे कि शर्माना नहीं और खा तू खा और फिक्र न कर कि एक मिस्कीन के पास बैठा है। मैंने बहुतीरा पूछा
کہ آپ کا نام کیا ہے
کہا نام کی فکر نہ کر بھائی نام کی فکر نہ کر تو کھا روزانہ بلا ناغا آتا تھا مگر تین دن ہوئے نہیں آئے اے بھائی تم بھی دعا کرو میں بھی دعا کروں کہ خدا اسے سلامت رکھے.